I'd like to introduce you to a new species to call Colorado home, the gray wolf. But are wolves really all that new to Colorado? Let's explore how the history and the biology of the gray wolf have shaped the past, present, and future of wolves in Colorado. Wolves are social creatures. Not quite like that. What I mean by social is that they are a part of what's called a pack. A pack is typically between 4 to 9 wolves, although one pack studied in Yellowstone National Park had 37 wolves. With all of this help, wolves are able to work together to hunt their prey, making it easier to take down much larger animals. Wolves are incredible predators. Being able to hunt the smallest of rodents to the largest of animals such as elk and moose. Wolves will chase down their prey, reaching speeds of 40 miles per hour. Seeking the most vulnerable animal in a herd, the pack will test the group by coordinating with other wolves to see how a herd will react. At times, the most vulnerable may be an animal that is sickly or injured, which is not only helpful for the wolf in getting a meal, but can also be helpful in maintaining the health of the herd by potentially reducing disease and competition for resources. Ungulates are our primary source of food for wolves, and one concern for some Coloradans is what type of impact will wolves have on this population? Right now, this is not an easy question to answer, and it's going to require years of monitoring and research. There are many factors that can impact a species population, including other predators, disease, and changes to the environment. Current research in other states have shown a range of conclusions, from wolves limiting the number of ungulates to other studies showing little to no effect. All of this can be due to differing factors, including the geographic scale, which can affect these populations. In charge of the pack are a male and female wolf, also known as the breeding pair. These wolves are not only in charge of the group, but also are the first to eat. This breeding pair are typically the only ones to have pups. Sometime around March, the female will dig a den into the earth where the pups will be protected for 9 weeks. Different wolves in the pack will take turns helping to raise the pups. As they grow, dominant and submissive behaviors develop in the pups, which is used to help define their role in the pack. Besides the pups and the breeding pair, the rest of the pack is typically composed of young wolves, around 1 to 4 years old. A wolf pack can be thought of as an extended family. Many pups will leave their home territory in order to search for a mate once they've become old enough. These wolves are called dispersers, and they can travel up to 600 miles from their home territory. We've even seen some of these wolves cross over into Colorado over the years. Oh, sorry, you caught me practicing my wolf hollow. Just like us, language is an important part of life for the wolf. They howl to claim territory, show their location to the pack and others, call to hunt, and even to show affection. Wolves aren't the only canine predators around. Coyotes, red foxes, and of course, domestic dogs can be seen across Colorado. But how do you tell the difference? The most likely canine you will encounter out in Colorado's trails is a dog. Ranging in size, color, and shape, variety is the name of the game when it comes to domestic dogs. While they are great hiking companions, they're obviously, well, not wolves. So who else might they be confused with? Ah, yes, the wily coyote. Ooh. Wolves and coyotes share similar habitats. You can find each of them in many types of landscapes, such as forests, grasslands, and even deserts. So if they are found in similar places, what makes them different? Although coyotes can live in family groups, you're more likely to see them hunting alone. This means they will typically go after smaller prey, such as rodents and rabbits, but can sometimes take down a deer or sheep. They will even eat berries to round out their diet. When it comes to looks, the wolf is large and in charge. With a larger torso and longer tail, it can be double the size of a coyote. While there is variation in their color, typically they're a pale gray or black, with overlaying black on their backs and legs. And as sharp as wolves can be mentally, their ears and nose are less pointed compared to a coyote. As you've seen, wolves are powerful predators who make a mark on the landscape with their incredible hunting abilities. But historically, people have not always welcomed wolves. Wolf populations were once more balanced within their habitat and with their prey, and also with the first caretakers of these lands, the indigenous people, many of whom were still connected to these lands and its wildlife today. However, as settlers moved westward during the early 19th century, some settled land to raise livestock and crops, while others sought opportunities to hunt animals such as elk and bison. Some hunters would bring these animals to market to sell, a concept known as market hunting, which for many species led to a large decline in their population size due to overhunting and a lack of regulations. It was during this time that wolves turned to another food source, livestock, and with this, some people began to view them as the enemy. As fear grew over large predators, many felt there was not enough space for both people and wolves. And so wolves and other predators began to be removed from the landscape. The goal was systematic eradication, or removal of predators so that people and livestock would be protected and populations of species like elk would increase. By the mid-1930s, wolves were almost extinct in the United States, and by the 1940s, Colorado no longer had wolves on the landscape. As we learned more about the ecological roles of wolves on the landscape, some states started efforts to recover the species, including the reintroduction of wolves to Yellowstone in 1995. Today, because of natural restoration and reintroduction efforts like this, gray wolves can now be seen in a handful of states, such as Idaho, Wyoming, and Michigan, just to name a few. Recently, we have seen wolves heading south into Colorado. And now with the passing of Proposition 114 by Colorado voters in 2020, Colorado Parks and Wildlife was tasked with restoring gray wolves to Colorado no later than December 31st, 2023. So why is understanding the biology and history of wolves important for successful wolf reintroduction? Let's look back at our reintroduction bridge again. Knowing the gray wolf's history in Colorado tells us why the species was removed from the landscape, while understanding wolf biology tells us what gray wolves will need to survive after they are reintroduced to Colorado. Both of these things are important for successful reintroduction. Thank you for joining me as we dove into the history and biology of wolves. Join us next time as we explore the importance of stakeholders in the next installment of our Wild Wolf Reintroduction Series.